There are four levels of human disaster measured in terms of the amount of casualties they inflict. There is death, there is killadeath, there is megadeath, and there is gigadeath. Many scientists and intellectuals believe that we may be entering the gigadeath era, and it's very important that you watch this video to completion so you can fully understand how dangerous the times we are currently living in truly are and why you need to be prepared for it. Let's get to it. Thousands and thousands of years ago, there was death. There was short periods of peace and a constant state of war. Hunter-gatherers, nomads, and ultimately very small villages of people with very little rule of law were in a constant struggle for survival. This was a period that was characterized by conflict and war, not only with the elements, but within groups, within tribes. Complications of health, complications of hunting, complications of sexual deviancy, constant disease, short lifespan, and a competition for resources would have made existence incredibly cumbersome throughout this time. Everyone who existed at this time had to possess basic fundamental survival skills. The survival skills that we now romanticize here on YouTube. The reason why this is referred to as the death period is because that deaths within this period typically occurred within the single or double digits, no matter what the engagement. Even if there was a conflict between tribes, hunter-gatherer communities were so small and so spread out throughout the world, and the human population around the world was so incredibly sparse, that any disaster that could have befallen human beings throughout that time could only ever, at a maximum, inflict maybe 1,000 casualties. Because people were so isolated from one another, diseases couldn't spread like they could around the world today. We did not have the means to engage in large-scale wars which took out thousands, if not millions, of people. Modern agriculture didn't create systems in which people could conglomerate in large numbers in small areas yet. So within these societies, the high bar for death is 1,000 deaths. This is the death era. The next era is the killadeath era. This is the era which is defined by deaths in excess of 1,000 per disaster scenario. The killadeath era is one in which humans started dying in much, much larger amounts as a result of natural or man-made disasters. There were longer periods of peace than there were in the previous period, but there were larger wars, and the consequences of these disasters was more catastrophic. Consider this: the Roman era. Civilizations have emerged. People have begun to leverage agriculture in order to support these larger empires. And then what happens? You get large-scale military engagements. You get large wars that kill thousands of people at a time. You get diseases because of poor living conditions in these primitive agricultural societies. Larger groups of people in smaller and smaller spaces. Most people within this killadeath era still had fundamental survival skills, but this also was where our domestication begins. Throughout the killadeath era, which I'm not going to temporally demarcate, because it would be very hard to determine the start and end point to these various eras, because you have different societies evolving in tandem throughout human history. So there may be a part of the map where people are still in the death era, and some people are in the megadeath era, and you could say the same thing is true today. But this is just a way to help us conceptualize and put in perspective the threats that we as a species actually face today. Now let's fast forward to the megadeath era. I would probably say that at least for Europe, the megadeath era began with the bubonic plague. This was the era where you start to see much, much longer periods of peace, But when catastrophe hits, it hits incredibly hard. This is the era of the Renaissance, the Industrial Revolution, and all throughout the 20th century. You had things like World War II. You had historic famines throughout the 19th and 20th century. Some were natural and some were man-made. Because the armies became bigger, so did the existential threats to our species. The Megadeath era is one in which the catastrophe is measured in the millions of casualties, not the thousands of casualties before the invention of black powder and bombs and airplanes and all of the 20th century technology that essentially preceded nuclear weapons. This was the Megadeath era, and it ended, arguably, with World War II. Although you could still say that we're in a transitional period from the Megadeath era to the Gigadeath era. Within the Megadeath era, you still had a large amount of the population, which was agrarian and rural. However, this is when we start to become more domesticated. Now, the terrifying thing is that it doesn't end at the Megadeath era. We would be foolish to think that we have changed, number one, that much fundamentally throughout the entirety of our evolution. Now remember, throughout that Megadeath period, you had increased, longer periods of peace, but shorter and more condensed catastrophes, which took out larger and larger amounts of people. And this trend has continued today. After WW2, you had the creation of the UN, and with the exception of some proxy wars that we've had that no doubt have caused a lot of suffering on the Megadeath level, we still have yet to exceed that. Because should we exceed the Megadeath level, it would be nearly apocalyptic. Now, why is it only now that Gigadeath is possible? Well, for starters, throughout the Megadeath era, there always was under 1 billion or 2 billion people. So Gigadeath would have basically been human extinction. But now, Gigadeath doesn't necessarily mean human extinction. But why is Gigadeath possible now, even if there are more people? Well, the answer is quite simple. The more technologically dependent, domesticated, and urbanized we become, the more existential threats present themselves. The greater our standard of living and the longer and more lush periods of peace that we currently enjoy, the greater the possibility for existential annihilation. This is a very hard concept for a lot of people to wrap their head around, because you would think that with such extended periods of peace and such relative abundance compared to the previous 10,000 years that was available to most people who were willing to work hard enough to get to it, to overcome whatever barriers were in their way, you would think the opposite would be true, and that Gigadeath was just a fantasy of some misanthropic nihilist. But that's not the case. The fact is, as we've become more urbanized, as we've become more technologically dependent, the existential threats against our species have increased. Never before have we had the capability to literally destroy billions of people in an hour. In a literal hour, we could destroy billions of people. This is why we are in the Gigadeath era, because the possibility exists, which is not to say that we are going to cross that point of no return. We may well progress into being a type 1 civilization somehow, some way, if we can get through this tumultuous transitional period that we're undergoing as a species, as we enter the globalist era. And I know that's a dirty word for a lot of people, but you need to comprehend that that is the future, whether it's going to be run by a nefarious cabal of elites that take everything for themselves and leave everybody crumbs, or whether that is going to be a more fair and equal process shared by all, that's unknown. But one thing is for certain, as soon as we created the atomic bomb, we entered the Gigadeath era. And as a side note, it's very appropriate and timely that some of the most intelligent people amongst us use a measure called the Doomsday Clock to show us how close we are to Gigadeath. But the threats to Gigadeath are numerous. It's not just about nuclear war. For example, there's many artificial intelligence researchers who question whether or not this poses an existential threat to humanity, either countries using AI in a war against each other, or a generalized form of AI actually turning on human beings. As we become increasingly more hardwired into the grid and everything becomes interconnected, whether it's encrypted or blockchain technology or not, there will always be the potential for cyber attack. And as we move into the cyborg age, the transhumanist age, where people start to modify themselves with technology and they themselves integrate technology into their biological framework, that means that the potential for these cyber attacks now extends beyond just the mere shutting down of your computer. It extends into shutting down you. Once again, another possibility for Gigadeath. Another possibility for Gigadeath is a massive solar flare, like what happened during the Carrington event in the mid-19th century. The Carrington event, fortunately, occurred when there was no modern technology, because if it did, it's likely that the entire power grid could potentially be compromised, not just in one country, but in many countries around the world, which could lead to cascading effects that would shut down the entire system and just lead to an all-out Mad Max world. This is very possible. We also have the possibility, and I know this is one that's a subject of debate within the preparedness community, but it is what it is. There's certainly a debate around whether or not climate disaster could be one of the contributing factors to this potential for Gigadeath. There's also, of course, the potential for a real, highly lethal strain, which was still very contagious, which took out millions, if not billions, of people. I'm not saying that it's likely, I'm just saying that it's possible, because now whatever virus presents itself has 8 billion potential hosts. And to top it all off is the fact that the majority of people nowadays have no survival skills whatsoever, because we're all heavily urbanized. Remember, in the death phase, everyone had survival skills. In the kill-a-death phase, people had agrarian skills. They knew animal husbandry. They knew how to grow their own food. And they generally had a greater appreciation for the reprieve earned from surviving the many struggles of the day that we now just take for granted. And most of us are completely oblivious to, because they are things which are offloaded to the grid. In the mega-death industrial period, people had survival skills still, but this is when people started to become urbanized. And fast forward to the Gigadeath period, where if the lights ever went out, we would be a few meals away from total anarchy. And this is not because human nature has fundamentally changed. It's simply because the systems that have emerged in tandem to allow us to support a population of 8 billion require a certain level of technological sophistication. If not achieved, we will not be able to effectively sustain such a high population. And then you're going to have what's called a Malthusian catastrophe, where the population is going to correct itself just like the stock market, and you are going to see a Gigadeath event. This is part of the reason why I prep, because remember when I started this discussion about how during a hunter-gatherer death phase, there was very short periods of peace throughout the day, you know, maybe when people were sleeping. But anytime there was activity, it was constant struggle, constant war. And as we progress up these phases to the Gigadeath phase, that's where you're going to see the longest periods of relative peace. But when disaster does finally strike, it is going to be short, it is going to be intense, and it is going to be cataclysmic. It's not a question of why should this happen. It's not a question of how will this happen. We know that it's possible, for the many reasons that I've laid out, that this could happen. That's not to say that it will happen. So far in our transition to being a type 1 civilization, humanity has demonstrated a certain resilience when up against the challenges that the 21st century brings. We've seen that throughout the last couple of years. The system still appears to be quite resilient, even though it's been pressure tested on numerous fronts. Now, for a lot of people, they would say, well, that wasn't really a fair test. yet, that we haven't truly been tested yet. But there were many times throughout the 20th century even, where Russia and the United States were very, very close from engaging in Gigadeath, but we didn't. So there's something to say for that. I'm not saying that it is going to happen. I'm saying that it's possible that it happens. So the point I'm trying to get across here is that never be lulled into a complacent mindset simply because the previous few generations have escaped a Gigadeath catastrophe. Because longer periods of peace, more intense catastrophes. We are currently in one of those long periods of peace. And the next move is either going to be Gigadeath or a transition to a Type 1 civilization in which we break this cycle. I personally think a Gigadeath scenario is more likely, but it is one of the fundamental reasons why I have a channel like this in the first place, because I do believe that our social order hangs in a delicate balance and it's nurtured by very fine components. And nothing, and I say absolutely nothing, is guaranteed. We cannot infer the future solely on the basis of the past. And if we were to do that, we would find that it was not looking like things are in our favor. So there are basically two outcomes for the human race right now. There's Gigadeath, which cascades into our possible extinction, or by some serendipitous course of events, we are able to keep this spaceship Earth operational. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. Canadian Prepper out.